Good evening. I would like to call to order the February 9th, 2015 Bellbrook City Council meeting to order. Would everyone please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call.
Mr. Edwards?
Here.
Mr. Greenwood?
Here.
Mr. Martin?
Here.
Mrs. Mittelstetter?
Here.
Mrs. Seeger Lawson?
Here.
Deputy Mayor Sweller?
Here.
And Mayor Bear?
Here. Formal approval of the work session and regular city council meeting minutes of January 26, 2015. Does any member on council have any corrections or additions to the regular city council meeting minutes of the last meeting? Seeing none, the minutes are approved as written. Mayor's announcements and special guests. We only have one this evening. We have Mr. Scott Carlson here to receive his oath of office to the Village Review Board. I would like to thank Mr. Carlson for volunteering for this board. And it's one of our, how many boards do we have? One, two, three, four, five? Five boards. This one hasn't been meeting a lot lately, has it?
No.
But it's one of those that ebbs and flows. Mr. Carlson, would you please come up here? And if you would please raise your right hand and repeat after me. I solemnly swear.
I solemnly swear.
That I will support the Constitution.
That I will support the Constitution.
Of the United States.
Of the United States.
And the Constitution.
And the Constitution.
Of the State of Ohio.
Of the State of Ohio.
And will obey the laws.
And will obey the laws.
Thereof.
Thereof.
I will in all respects.
I will in all respects.
Uphold and enforce.
Uphold and enforce.
The provisions of the Charter.
The provisions of the Charter.
And the ordinances.
And the ordinances.
Of Bellbrook.
Of Bellbrook.
And will faithfully discharge.
And will faithfully discharge.
The duties of the office.
The duties of the office.
Upon which I'm about to enter.
Upon which I'm about to enter.
Congratulations and thank you very much. And I just need a signature.
That's for the signing bonus.
Signing bonus, yeah.
I feel like I've been drafted, so.
And that is it, I'll date it. And thank you very much. And I do not have any other announcements this evening. Ordinances, ordinance number 2015-1, Mr. Greenwood.
Yes, Mayor. Excuse me. Ordinance number 2015-1. An ordinance amending chapter 1610 of the Bellbrook Municipal Code, establishing the fire code enforced by the Bellbrook Fire Department. Whereas the city of Bellbrook has enacted chapter 1610 of the Bellbrook Municipal Code, which is entitled Bellbrook Fire Department Unified Code, and whereas the purpose of chapter 1610 is to protect the peace, health, safety, and welfare of the citizens of Bellbrook, and whereas chapter 1610 Bellbrook Fire Department Unified Fire Code defines the addition of the fire code that has been adopted, and whereas the city of Bellbrook desires to update the fire code references in the municipal code. Now therefore the city of Bellbrook hereby ordains. Section 1, that the following amendment to chapter 1610 of the Bellbrook Municipal Code be approved with deletions shown by brackets and strike through and additions shown by italics and underlined. 1610.01, 1994 edition adopted. Purpose is hereby amended as follows. Pursuant to section 5.07 of the city charter, there is hereby adopted and incorporated by reference as if set out at length herein, for the purpose of prescribing regulations for the safeguarding to a reasonable degree of life and property from hazards of fire and explosion arising from the storage, handling, and use of hazardous substances, materials, and devices, and from conditions hazardous to life or property in the use of occupancy of buildings or premises. The Ohio Fire Code, as promulgated in Chapter 1301-7 of the Ohio Administrative Code. 1610.02, interpretation is hereby amended as follows. The fire code is adopted in 1610.01 shall be construed to affect the responsibility of any party owning, operating, or installing any equipment for damage to persons or property caused by any defect therein, nor shall the city be held as assuming any such liability by reason of any inspection or re-inspection authorized herein or any permit issued as herein provided, or by reason of the approval or disapproval of any equipment authorized herein. 1610.99, penalty and equitable remedies is hereby amended as follows. Whoever violates any of the provisions of this fire prevention code, including the fire code adopted in section 1610.01, or fails to comply therewith, or violates or fails to comply with any order made thereunder, or builds in violation of any detailed statement of specifications or plans submitted and approved thereunder, or any certificate or permit issued thereunder for which no penalty is otherwise provided and for which no appeal has been taken, or fails to comply with such provision or as affirmed or modified by the code official of the city or by a court of competent jurisdiction within a time fixed therein, is guilty of a misdemeanor of the first degree and shall be fined not more than $1,000 or imprisoned not more than 6 months or both for each offense. When not otherwise specified, a separate offense shall be deemed committed each day during or on which a violation occurs or continues. Section B, the imposition of any one penalty for any violation shall not excuse the violation or permit to continue. And all persons who violate the fire code shall be required to correct or remedy such violations or defects within a reasonable time period. The application of the penalty provided herein shall not be held to preclude other additional remedies as provided by law. Section 2, that this ordinance shall take effect and be enforced from and after the earliest period provided by law. I think mainly it's some changes in the text as far as the fire code, the unified fire code, that was main.
Yes, so periodically we'll review different sections of code. The previous section actually referenced the 1994 edition of the fire code. There's been a more recent version that we have been using, but we just want to clarify the municipal code. And with the changes here, it will tie us directly to what's adopted by the state of Ohio, which is what we'll use going forward. So when there's a new edition adopted, council won't have to take action. We'll just use the most current version. Fire department will do that in their enforcement action. So yeah, there were just some minor modifications there to show that change. And then this will be set for a public hearing to be held at the next council meeting.
So there's really just two small sections that just essentially are making it go to the higher revised code. That's
correct. That's the administrative code, but yes.
Or, yeah, administrative, not yes. Revised.
Is there no longer a unified fire code, or just it's just referred to instead as fire code?
It's just referred to as the fire code, okay. As opposed to the unified. When I went and did the research on this, there are some references to multiple fire codes, and that's why it was unified. But now there is just one fire code listed in the Ohio Administrative Code.
And this is just an introduction, too, so yes. We will have a public hearing. Any other questions on council? May I have a motion to pass ordinance number or
introduce
ordinance number 2015-1.
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to introduce ordinance number 2015-1.
I'll second.
I have a motion by Mr. Greenwood to introduce ordinance number 2015-1, amending chapter 1610 of the Bellbrook Municipal Code, establishing the fire code enforced by the Bellbrook Fire Department. This will set a public hearing for February 23rd. Seconded by Mr. Martin. Mr. Greenwood?
Yes.
Mr. Martin?
Yes.
Mr. Edwards?
Yes.
Mrs. Mittelstetter?
Yes.
Mrs. Seeger Lawson?
Yes.
Mr. Schweller?
Yes.
And Mayor Baird?
Yes. Moving on, resolutions. We have two this evening. Resolution number 2015-C. Mr. Schweller?
Yes, Mayor. Resolution 2015-C. Resolution authorizing Robert L. Baird, Mayor of the City of Bellbrook, to enter into an amended employment agreement with Mark A. Schlockheck, City Manager / Finance Director. Whereas the Council of the City of Bellbrook and Mark A. Schlockheck desire to amend their written employment agreement, whereas it is required that the Council of the City of Bellbrook, pursuant to Article 6, Section 6.01 of the Bellbrook Charter, shall appoint a city manager by a majority vote of its members and fix his or her compensation. Now, therefore, the City of Bellbrook hereby resolves, Section 1. Robert L. Baird, as Mayor of the City of Bellbrook, is hereby authorized to execute an amended employment agreement with Mark A. Schlockheck on behalf of the City of Bellbrook. Section 2, the amended employment agreement is hereby attached. In Section 3, that this resolution shall take effect and be enforced immediately upon adoption. And the change we're making to the contract is we are increasing the medical insurance waiver reimbursement, which Mark receives, from $5,000 per year to $7,000 per year. And I think that's the only change, Mark.
To this contract, correct.
Yes, okay.
Yeah.
And that change is that Mr. Schlockheck does not take insurance with the City of Bellbrook. A lot of cities probably pay the whole amount back, which would be over probably $12,000.
Right.
And we have agreed to pay the $7,000. And we talked about it at our last executive session and the council meeting. Does anyone on council have any questions?
No, Mayor.
No.
Seeing none, I have a motion to adopt Resolution 2015-C.
Mayor, I'd like to move for the adoption of Resolution 2015-C.
May I have a second?
I'll second.
I have a motion by Mr. Schweller to adopt Resolution number 2015-C, authorizing the Mayor of the City of Bellbrook, Robert L. Baird, to enter into an agreement with Mr. amended agreement with Mr. Schlockheck, City Manager, Finance Director. Mr. Schweller?
Yes.
Mrs. Seeger Lawson?
Yes.
I'm sorry, seconded by Mrs. Seeger Lawson. Mr. Edwards?
Yes.
Mr. Greenwood?
Yes.
Mr. Martin?
Yes.
Mrs. Mittelstetter?
Yes.
And Mayor Baird?
Yes. One more resolution this evening, Resolution 2015-D. Mrs. Seeger Lawson.
Resolution number 2015-D, a resolution authorizing the city manager to enter into an agreement for the purchase of the city's cell tower lease. Whereas several vendors have prepared proposals for the acquisition of the city's current cell tower lease with Crown Castle, and whereas the proposals offer a lump sum purchase price for the acquisition and a share of future additional rent, and whereas the city would no longer receive the annual and monthly lease payments from Crown Castle per the terms of the current lease agreement, and whereas the final acquisition will be subject to due diligence performed by all interested parties, now therefore the City of Bellbrook hereby resolves, Section 1, that the city manager is hereby authorized to execute an agreement for the purchase of the city's cell tower lease by a third-party vendor. Section 2, that this resolution shall take effect and be enforced forthwith.
Yes, I mentioned this briefly at the last council meeting. The city has a cell tower on its property down in the well field down here on South Main Street. That tower has been there since 1997. When it was first built by GTE Wireless, the city had an agreement with them and we received payment. We still own the land, but we leased the land to, it was GTE Wireless, now it's Crown Castle. And at the time, in December of 1997, it was $12,000 per year is what we received for that lease of that land. There's been a subsequent change to that lease agreement, and it has amended it, and we now, that $12,000 increases annually by the Consumer Price Index. The agreement now extends through December of 2047 in a series of five-year lease terms, so that lease can be terminated at the end of any five-year period. In addition, we receive, if there is another carrier that is placed on that tower, we receive additional money. It started out at $1,000 per month, and again, that has been increased by the Consumer Price Index. So as it is right now, we receive just over $32,000 a year for that lease on that cell tower. That's what we receive. And again, it increases annually in July by the Consumer Price Index. So that's, the last several years has just been about 2% or so. So it's gone up slightly each year. So we have received actually two proposals from two different purchasers of these. And they have offered us a lump sum payment to basically buy out our lease rights to that thing. So instead of receiving that $32,000 a year, they would pay us a lump sum price up front. Between the two proposals, that ranges between $400,000 and $432,000. In addition, we would get any 50% of any future rents for any new carriers that were added. Right now, the T-Mobile and Clearwire are the two carriers that are on that tower. So if somebody else went on that tower, we would receive 50% of that money going forward. We've had several conversations. I talked with the mayor and the deputy mayor about this. We've talked about some different things. Really, what this resolution that's before you would authorize me to pursue one of these proposals further. But really, before we do that, I think there's an overall discussion about whether this is the right thing to do or not. Obviously, it's a fairly significant lump sum payment that we'd be getting up front. I look back, I had a proposal from 2011 from a different company, and it was half the amount that was offered, that is being offered now. We had a conversation with somebody who deals with some of this, and there's a much more of a market today because of the data that's going through these. There's a need for more cell towers, more antennas, things of that nature. But what it comes down to, is it the right price? And do we want to give up that future stream of revenue? And this all comes down to financial questions that none of us have a crystal ball can answer right now, because there's a lot of variables based on what the consumer price index is, how much we can earn on that money going forward, things of that nature. Interest rate assumptions, and then technology. When this started in 1997, I don't know that anyone could have dreamed that we'd be talking about cars that were driven off of cell towers and people that, you know, can do anything off of that. Where's it going to be in 10, 15, 20 years? Is cell technology what it's going to be, or is it going to be something else? At any point, at any one of those five-year terms, they can make that tower obsolete, take the antennas down, and we'll get nothing going forward. So that's the other side of this. Although the lease goes till 2047, who knows if we'll actually get that money for that entire period of time. So like I said, we've had several discussions about this, and I have a net present value calculation. I mean, that's really what it comes down to if we want to entertain the thought. So I know, like I said, I've talked with the mayor, and I know you have some thoughts on this. And
yeah, I don't know that there's a right answer yet. I think what this resolution tonight actually gives Mark the power to go out and further negotiate. It's not necessarily going out and signing an agreement. That's not what this is all about. This is giving him the authority to go out and negotiate to find the best deal, and then we would have to have a good discussion on if it is worth it or not. The downsides are we really don't know how many more attachments there are going to be on the tower. New attachments are generally, we're receiving around $12,000 a year. If we would sell our lease rights, then we would probably get the, you know, $6,000 a year. But we'd also be losing our $32,000 a year of income, but also have the $400,000 issue. The biggest issue I have, and I can't tell you if it's a good decision or not, is that we can't invest our money, and the most we can make is around 1%. So another variable is, especially when you're looking at net present value, is how much can you invest that money for? And because of statutory reasons, we're only going to, at least for the foreseeable future, get around 1%. The other side, not to sell it, is CPI is not a bad thing to have on $32,000 going forward, especially when interest rates are. So there isn't a right answer. I think realistically, if we had the, you know, $400,000 in the bank, what would that do for the city? It would obviously offset some of our expenses. It would probably delay going to the voters potentially, but it wouldn't delay it very much. It'd be a year or two probably at the most, because we haven't had a levy on since the last police
2011.
Would
it offset our, do we need to go out for debt? I
Well, we don't have any debt, and the only debt we have is in the water system, and this is general fund money, the water system money. We have enough to pay that off now, and that's at, what, 2-3%, 2-7?
Between 2-3%.
Between 2-3% now.
Some of it's at zero.
Yeah, some of it's at zero, so, and we have enough money in the bank in theory, not that you're going to use it when you're only paying that small amount of interest rate. But this money would all be general fund money, which is a very positive thing if we would decide to do it. They're obviously raising us from 200 and whatever thousand from 2011 to this amount today because they're forecasting or speculating, is a better term, that there are going to be more attachments and they're going to need the added bandwidth to for all the technology that's out there today.
What are the most attachments we've ever had on the tower?
We have two.
It's never been any more than that?
No.
When did we get the last one, or when did we get to it? On the starter, were they?
2007 or so is when they put the second one on. I mean, there was one on originally, and then there was a second one added in 2007.
Mark, my apologies if a lot of this got covered at the working session. I wasn't able to attend. At the five-year point, you talked about these are in five-year increments. Are we able to cancel as well? Or is it just they're able to cancel?
I believe we could cancel, but it's their tower.
We don't own it.
We don't own the tower.
I understand.
Yeah. But yes, we could cancel, but I don't know.
Well, I don't do a lot of this, right? But I can tell you, if a company is offering you 12 years of current revenue, mm-hmm. they're going to get a lot more than that mm-hmm. the second they have. Right?
It's changed dramatically, and the 12 to 13 years is a pretty, in general terms, for these kind of things is very good compared to what it used to be.
But
they obviously know something.
Yes.
Yeah. And we're all in agreement there.
Right.
And those are the variables we don't know. They could also cancel in 5 years.
Correct. But the rates that I've seen for cell towers have gone up dramatically more than CPI as new towers have been added. In other words, to go out and get a lease today, there's a lot of places in urban areas where they're able to put a tower, and I'm not saying this is urban, but they're paying that much a month. So, you know, again,
right, which is
what the future is going to hold. But I mean, this company clearly knows that there's a lot of money to be made off of this particular tower.
And I think we're sort of understand that, and we also know that the times have changed because it's essentially almost doubled what we were offered before, maybe not double, was it two?
No, it's more than double.
More than double.
Right. Yeah. So if we wait 500 years.
So, I said earlier, the 32,000 in a lot of theories goes a pretty long way, especially with CPI. And also keep in mind, though, if there's more attachments, we still get that half of that revenue. The only difference would be we would get all the revenue. Instead of 6,000 a year, we would get 12,000 a year. So if there are more attachments, which also leads into potential of, you know, water towers and other things we own. But so what this does tonight is give Mark the authority to go out and say, is this really the best deal?
I don't know, the way this is worded, it says enter into an agreement.
It is enter into an agreement. It doesn't mean we're going to agree to it.
It's probably a two-step process because I can enter into an agreement or sign a letter. Basically, there's a due diligence period in that, but ultimately to sign over the lease rights, council's going to have to approve that to, mm-hmm. to sign those legal documents. So I guess I know what it says and I can do that, but I guess what I'm looking for is that what council, I mean, I'm fine. I was telling Carrie earlier, this is probably the first time I ever put a resolution on that I don't know which way it's going to go, and it doesn't matter. This is what we need to discuss and decide. We can say no to the resolution and move on and keep our CPI. If anything, what I've learned is we need to find the people that can add more antennas to this tower one way or the other. There's somebody out there that we need to go to, and we've had the discussion, and I know Mr. Wilson has had discussions with some people about potentially putting something on the water tower at some point. But that's another avenue where we actually own that, and we're not going to share that revenue with anybody. we have other potential issues with access to water towers and things of that nature, but that's something else that we may want to pursue separate of this. So I guess the question I have is this, is this the financial deal, or is there a number that we're going to say, if $430,000 isn't the number, what is the number that we would consider this? Or do we want to keep our ongoing lease until, and take that chance, so to speak?
Who gets the benefit of the attachments? We get the benefit of
we get a portion
50%.
Of it.
50% right now?
Well,
no, we get 100%.
No, we
get 100%.
No, we don't get 100%.
Well,
we get
our lease payment of $1,200.
Which start, yeah, the $1,271 is because there is an attachment on there. If there's another attachment today, we would start getting $1,271 a month based on that. Now, what that carrier is paying to be on there could be $2,500, could be $3,000 a month, but Crown Castle, they're the ones who are getting that money. All they're obligated to do is pay us $1,271.
So they're the ones that are actively marketing the attachment possibly.
Yeah, the only upside, they're buying out a lease. They're not buying the tower. All they're doing is buying our lease,
right,
which is clear that each attachment, they only get X amount.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So it's not, you know, so the upside for them is that they know they'll probably get another attachment, and it's going to be, yeah.
Yeah, so, Mark, we looked at this before. It was always about $200,000, and net present value was so easy to do the calculation and decide that this wasn't worthwhile, but now it's something that's worth consideration. I think we should consider it. We should maybe talk to Crown Castle and see if there's any ideas from their standpoint of putting more stuff on the tower. I would like to know, because whoever's going to buy this thing for that kind of a multiple, and they say in the market these are trading for 11 to 14 years of annual revenue, so we're right in the sweet spot. In fact, we're at the high end of it. And you know, for those guys to make that thing work, they have got to put a lot of attachments on it right away to get this thing juiced up and start producing some revenue.
Man.
So it seems like it's worth pursuing.
I'm just really curious if they're planning to renegotiate the lease.
But
I was just thinking about that, and I guess that's where you're going with the ability to terminate.
Right.
Once they own that lease and they've paid us our money, they could terminate the lease.
And
with,
say
with Crown
and say,
Castle and say we're going to read it.
Say, guess what, Crown Castle? You need to move your tower.
Right, because the lease is terminated, and if
right.
you don't pay us more,
yeah,
yes,
you got to take your tower.
You got to take your tower down, and we're going to yes.
Couldn't we ask for more than the CPI, the increase? But is there any way for us?
Sure, we can do whatever.
We have a lease that says that it's the CPI, and we agreed to that. But yes, we could ask for
you
more.
You know, when you have a right to cancel the lease, then everything's up for negotiations. And I guess I didn't read it close enough.
I was just
cancel it. That's I don't know. Usually both parties, but we probably would need to verify that.
There has to be something good there. They wouldn't have made the offer.
Well, the offer historic that you know it keeps getting better, and historical mm-hmm. values is pretty good. And by no means am I saying we should do it. Mm-hmm. I am probably saying we should go one step further and let Mark investigate it.
Definitely investigate it.
Because you know. The net present value, because we make so little interest, is still mm-hmm. super high.
Yeah.
You know, it's in the $800,000-$900,000 range for the 47 years mm-hmm. because of we don't have the opportunity of a regular business to make 6% or 7% or 5%.
Yeah.
Or invest it.
We got both these offers last week, didn't we, effectively?
Yes.
So it's relatively brand new type thing. So.
Yeah. I think one of the offers had an
expiration date this week.
February 11th or something.
Yeah. Yes.
Just a quick look at the agreement here. We could terminate the agreement at any one of those 5-year periods.
So every 5 years it kind of gets reviewed.
Right. It reviews automatically unless somebody says something.
So it's a 5-year evergreen unless someone raises their hand.
When's the next 5 years expire?
Probably 17. If it was passed in 97.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think it makes sense to at least explore what our options are.
Yeah, and I think if anyone has any inside input, I know Mike and I have both talked to people we know,
yep.
and there really isn't. A lot of it is going to be speculative. Mm-hmm. We aren't going to know the answer. They could also terminate the lease in 5 years, and you know we'd be done with our $32,000 a year plus CPI. Or we could cancel it, and I don't know what they do with the physical property.
Yeah, I think it's spelled out in there. If we cancel it, they've got to take it down and remove it.
And it also, there could be another spot that when I negotiate them for a particular utility company that someone wanted to put on our property, I put it too high and it went 100 yards away and they have a lease that's probably worth what ours is today. So you don't know. There isn't a correct answer.
No, absolutely.
No matter what we end up doing. But I think it's a good idea to at least have Mark talk. And if anyone on council has any input, they can contact Mark. Any suggestions or insider information?
And I think these towers are going to be the wave of the future. There's tons of them out there right now. There's going to be more of them. They're probably going to be putting new parts on a lot of them and upfitting them. They're going to put new attachments on these things. And I would think we've got a pretty decent risk that if we don't do something with it, they may just find a bigger and better tower and stick with that. Mm-hmm. And obsolete ours, I don't know. Yeah.
And it's sort of interesting where ours is located. It's in a valley. There's a reason. Yeah. And then, of course, we have portable cell service in Bellbrook with certain companies. So I would think that one company would want to attach, but it's not like our tower's on the high spot of the county. Right. It's in a low spot. And now our water tower is another story. So that's another thing we could always look at is potential income.
Well, we need a tower down here in the low spot so we can all get...
Depends on which service you have. Some of them work great. Yeah. Some of them...
That's true.
...do not.
Depends on who's attached.
Yeah.
You're talking about the water towers, placing some things on there. Is that something we would have to come up with the money and build, or
no?
No.
No.
No. That would be we would lease the tower.
Just lease it.
Just lease it again.
We'd have to provide access and power.
Power. Yeah.
So there wouldn't be that much we'd have to.
No. Well, no. Again, probably our biggest concern there is access to the tower itself and continuous access to that, and the security of the towers themselves are probably the biggest thing that is our concern from that.
Yeah. So it's not a lot of capital you got to put out
there. I wouldn't think there'd be any capital. I mean, that's just like this. I mean, they basically came in and they built this tower. We didn't spend anything. We just gave them the rights to build on our ground, and it was all their capital cost up front because they're going to recoup it from better service.
Yeah.
You have anything to add to that, Dale?
The only concern I have about the water tower is the security of
And Dale said, for the people who couldn't hear him, his only concern is that he has a concern to make sure the water towers are secure.
And we appreciate that concern, Dale.
We like our water.
We sure do.
Any other questions? I think, you know, you can, there's a lot of potentials and a lot of unknowns, but I think until we get a solid number and a lease agreement and maybe a couple good questions to ask. Then may I have a motion to adopt resolution 2015-D?
I guess before you, I mean, I don't know that you necessarily have to adopt the, I mean, if you're not comfortable with doing this, because I guess
can
I'm not.
Can you negotiate without it?
I can negotiate without it. This was because there was an offer that was expiring on February 11th. And when this started, that was to give me the authority to sign that agreement. I don't know, based on what you've said tonight, that the other offer that we got did not have an expiration date on it. I'm sure there's probably a period to it, but I guess based on what I have tonight, I don't know that you need to pass this. I don't know that it harms anything, but I don't know that you need to pass it, because I'll just continue. I'll contact Crown Castle and continue to do some due diligence to see what we can do.
Yeah, and I don't have a problem with that. Do we need to make a motion and then not vote it down, or we have to vote it? Well,
if no one makes a motion to pass it, then
okay, I'm not making a motion.
Okay.
Because
no motion.
No motion, because, you know.
We're motionless.
We're motionless. Speakers, okay. So we will not have a motion on resolution 2015-D, and I agree with that. Any other comments on council before we move on?
Is that good enough direction for you, Mark, then, as far as?
Yeah, I think, like I said, it was really the first offer that had the expiration date that sort of drove the resolution, but now
so
with
bigger.
The second one, and then the second one was actually the higher of the two offers anyway. So
mm-hmm.
We can continue and do that, and then see what other options are, and then I'll come back to you, and we meet again in 2 weeks. So
yeah, and I think we're in a strong negotiating position, because I think we're fine. Keep not taking the money, or you know, 5 years from now
right.
We may not be saying that, but so
Can you counter that offer? I mean.
Sure.
Multiple 15.
Multiple 15. That's getting pretty high. It really is not a, I mean, historically with these, that's pretty good.
Oh, it's a very good offer, which tells me, something we don't.
I agree.
That's what tells me.
So moving on, city manager's report.
Yes, a couple items here. The first is the water service area agreement. Let me find it here. We've had discussions in the past about an agreement with Green County. We have, and we've gone back. We made an offer to Green County that we would, this is the area, let me back up here, I'm sorry. So this area that looks like it's in purple over here is the area behind the Walmart and Staples Center here. The way the current agreement with Green County works is there's a line that literally goes through this parcel. Our water tower sits right down here in this corner here. There's a line that goes right through the middle of this. So any development that goes in theory, the part in blue would be served by the Bellbrook water system and the purple would be served by the Green County water system. Well, obviously that doesn't really work from a developer standpoint. And it's sort of redundant. So what we did and went back and we offered to the county is that we would take over service for this purple area whenever it would develop, and we would pay them $1,000 for any tap that went into this. They came back and initially wanted something significantly more than that. We talked on council about that. We went back and said, we're not going to do that. They've come back and offered that if they could get 50% of the tap-in revenue for any of those taps, mm-hmm. that they would probably be able to come to an agreement. Right now, our tap-in fee is $2,800, so 50% would be $1,400. So basically, today, it would be an increase of $400 for any tap that went in there. There was recently just a development that was proposed that's been since pulled, but this is all in the township. That would have 207 units. So if you took half of those and they were in the township or in the Green County service area, that's what we'd be talking about. So you could be talking about 100 units, an additional $400 that we would, I guess, not get from that revenue going forward. But what I think it does is would clarify this area here. This area in green is where the Possumon Creek runs. It's parkland. It won't ever be developed. The area in blue is just to the south of the Possum Run extension. And the area in yellow is another one that's actually just to the north of the Possum Run Road extension. There's that little triangle of land that's actually in the city of Centerville. And it would be service. It's in theory in the Green County service area, but we would we have asked that would be included in our service area. But they would not get that tap-in revenue from that because they would have to bore under the road to get a water main over there. It makes no sense whatsoever. So what I guess, if council's fine with this, I would go back to Green County and agree to 50% of the tap-in revenue from this area in purple and that this area in yellow we would get 100% of the tap-in. There's probably would only be one or two taps in there anyway. And the blue would remain as it is today, which is it's in our service area. What this does is lock up, we could extend that agreement, and then we can quit having to talk about this, I guess. Probably the biggest benefit
ever again.
Every time there's a development proposed.
Yeah.
Mark, would they be okay with just saying it's a $1,400 fee?
I will go back and ask that. I mean, that's why we did the $1,000 to begin with, was because it was a flat amount, and then if we raise tap fees, which we're going to talk about later tonight, it doesn't increase as we go to do that, and, right. and they don't get benefit just because we raise the tap fee. So that would be something that we could offer. I don't know that they would be or not.
What the tap fees are, if I'm understanding correctly, are for future maintenance and expenses that we would
yes.
face. If who puts the water lines and things in that it becomes, if it's our water service area, we put the lines in?
No, the developer puts those in.
The developer puts
those in. So whoever's going in there is going to put the water lines in originally to our specifications.
Okay.
And then once they are complete, we are going to take ownership of them, and then we're going to have maintenance responsibility forever.
From so
now.
That's
and
that, what the
and,
tap
and that's what the tap-in fee is intended is those water mains, hopefully we don't have to do anything for 50 years, but
some of the water, the cost of the water also accumulates towards escrow for maintenance?
Yes. In addition to the tap fees, that's, there's built in for the maintenance of the system ongoing, for water tower maintenance, for any part of that system is all built in, and that's where we accumulate that money to pay for those long-term capital improvements.
So basically, they're just selling their right to have the water?
Yes.
Service in that area?
Yes.
Which they don't provide anyway?
Right, I mean, Montgomery County that they resell to whoever it is here. It's not their water that they're generating. So that other portion where you're talking about the surplus that comes from the water rate to pay for those, they're not really doing that. They're passing through the cost from Montgomery County onto us because that's where the water's being produced.
Yeah, okay.
And then the county has higher rates than us, too.
So if that's acceptable.
Is there an opportunity to counter, or is that, we've already kind of been through?
Well, yeah, I mean, I guess that's what I'm going, there's not a formal counter offer on the table, so I guess I was gonna, we can either accept the 50%, we can go to a flat dollar amount, or we can come up with something else.
I would like to see us go to a flat dollar amount of $1,400, and that way, it leaves us a little bit of flexibility, and should we want to do something in a year or two or three or whatever, it leaves it to us. Versus having to always think about, well, we got to split that.
Right. That's fine. I mean, at this point, we don't know what's going to happen. This land could be undeveloped.
Sitting there forever.
20 years, yeah.
Or it could be.
And it becomes a moot point.
Right. Or it could have, you know, four taps in it, in which point it doesn't really matter. It could have 400, and then it does matter.
Yeah.
You know, so, but basically, Green County's selling their rights to provide that water to those people. We have the capacity and the ability to do that.
The last plan was pulled that they were going to put those apartments in there?
I think they were having some difficulty at the public hearings.
Yes, they had some less than positive feedback on the proposed plan. So it's been pulled completely, and what the representatives from the township said at the Chamber of Commerce meeting was that the plan is to reinduce another plan. Whether that happens or not, we don't know. So,
or the timing of that.
Exactly. So in some ways, that plan being pulled is probably more favorable to come to an agreement now when there's not something on the table, and let's just agree to something, and then we can not have to deal with this when it comes up. This is one of the few areas that is really, the line goes through undeveloped land. So you don't know what's going on. This is one of the few areas. Everything, all the Dilley property and that on the northwest side of Clio Road, as you go over there, that's all Green County, and we don't have any water over there. It would be difficult for us to serve that.
Yeah. I like Mr. Martin's idea of a flat.
Horace?
I do, too.
I have a problem paying them anything, because...
Fair enough.
Yeah, we all understand
like
that.
You know, we've made some common sense decisions on it since I've been on the council. With, you know, letting Green County have some areas, no charge, you know, nothing attached. They don't even have a system available. It, to me, it's like paying tribute for nothing. I mean, as far as a water customer or taxpayer, you look at it like, okay, it just doesn't make sense. The taxpayers kind of getting a raw deal. Commissioners are making their money to place whatever, you know.
Wouldn't disagree. It's just that pesky thing about Green County has to give water permits outside of the city limits. That could be a little grief.
I absolutely agree.
But I think we all have your sentiment, Forrest.
I know. It's a part of the game.
John, you're a Elaine.
Yeah, I think it's the best of what we can arrange, knowing the history of Green County and water.
Donna?
I don't want to nickel and dime it to death, but I just, it seems like we offered 1,000, they are now offering 1,400. Should we come back right in the middle at 1,200? That's my only gut reaction. Flat number. But if it's just gonna like,
well, compared to what they wanted before,
which was everything,
they wanted double tap.
They wanted more. So they wanted double tap ins that were way, way, way down from that.
Yeah.
Which we, of course, would have generated the same amount of revenue, if it would not have been very business friendly to developers.
Right.
So we're really being good guys, so to speak, not knowing what would really happen if we were going to fight over those customers either.
Yeah.
That's the issue. We don't know. We don't know if the developer would go to Greene County and make an agreement with Montgomery, we would have nothing. Mm-hmm. We don't know that. So I don't know. I think I'm okay with 14.
I would tell them council's preference might be to go to 1,200 with a fixed fee and see what they say.
Doesn't hurt.
Just say that would be our preferable approach, just to split the difference.
How about that, an approval to go 14 if it doesn't go, so yeah, we don't have to keep coming back and forth.
And hopefully they're not watching this.
It is a public meeting.
Yeah.
What is their process? You talk to Brandon, then he goes and talks to the trustees, and they think about it, and they come back with a couple of days later with a decision. Yeah. Or something.
What I'll do is put a.
It's almost executive session stuff.
No, it's. But again, it's fine. I'll go back and offer and say this is what we've discussed,
true.
And here's the parameters, and you know, if they want to counter offer something back, they can. But you know, that's where we are.
Okay.
Good point, Mark.
Let's not talk about 1350 though, okay?
Yeah.
No. All right.
Okay, a couple other items then. The Third Season restaurant, the old Frosty Eagle, is now open.
Oh, wow.
It opened a week ago Sunday.
Third Season?
Third Season is the name of it. So if you have the opportunity, I think they're open from like 11 to 8 p.m., 11 a.m. to 8 p.m. So if you get a chance, go down there and try that. And then the Vemco Firebird Stormwater Project. We've talked about that got grant funding approved. That grant funding for the construction is available July 1st, but we are going to begin the engineering actually here shortly. We've signed a contract. I just approved a draft letter to go out to the neighbors there because the surveyors are going to be out there the first week of March. So people are going to see some surveyors in their yards, their backyards, and that, trying to get everything taken care of there. So our plan is to have the engineering done by July 1st so we can go out to bid, and then we hope to have the project complete by the end of the year is the plan. So we will be doing that here over the next several months.
Mark, do we know why there has been such a problem there?
Yes. The design of how the water flows now, there's a head wall that is there, and it's at an angle. It goes into a manhole that's at another angle. So what happens is things get caught up, things get blocked up, and that's what this project is intended to fix, is from that head wall down to where the creek comes, is making it a more straight, it's probably not a straight shot, but a shot that does not have those catch points.
Okay.
Bigger pipe, I think there's a mishmash of pipe in there already, so just things like that. When it was all put together originally, it was probably done in different developers doing different things. What we're going to do is fix it from that head wall where it comes to the creek, and it will have, it's similar to what we did over here behind Dollar General, where by doing that we've just cleaned everything up, it all goes through the pipe is correctly sized, and we'll eliminate all those issues.
Okay. It just seemed like, why did it get that way in the first place?
It's old. I mean, that's part of it too.
It was probably built from three different developers over 15 years or
something. And the capacity probably was never intended to. And the way stormwater was designed back then is not what the standards are today.
Okay.
What people were held accountable to back then are not nearly what we hold them accountable to now.
Okay.
So.
Thanks.
That's all I have for my report.
Does anyone on council have any questions for our city manager this evening? If not, we'll move on to committee report service.
I don't have anything tonight.
Safety?
I don't have anything, right, Mayor.
Finance and audit?
Mayor, nothing to report this evening.
Community affairs?
The only thing I have is that a lot of folks remember Pat Campbell, who was on council for a number of years. She's got some health problems and is back in the hospital. So
did not know that. When did she? Okay, I'll talk to you later.
I just learned Sunday that she was back in the hospital. So she was in the hospital, went to a rehab center, now is back in the hospital. Mm. At Kettering. So those of you who know Pat and remember her years and years of service, both on council and the fair board.
Chamber of Commerce, too.
Hmm?
Chamber of Commerce for years, too.
Chamber of Commerce for years. She was on the, served out at the fair.
The Greene County
years.
Fair Board forever.
So send her your
indeed,
thoughts
Camel.
And prayers. And that's it for Mr. Mandy.
Moving on, old business. Does anyone on council have any old business? Seeing none, new business. We have one item, water system and water rates review.
Yes, this time of year, we always review the water rates. This year, we've got a few other things to go over along with the water rates. And the service department, it's probably been a year and a half ago, prepared a video overview of the water system that they showed at our safety day that we held. And it was really intended for the employees of the police department, the fire department to look at, that maybe get a better understanding. What I asked Mr. Wilson to do was to edit that video so that we could play it. We'll probably put it on Bellbrook TV. We'll put it on the website because it's fairly informative. So it's about a five-minute video that I'm going to show you here, if I can get everything to work as it should. Oops. Which one is it, Dale? I can't see. There it is. All right, Louie, do you have the sound on?
Thumbs up. Over.
Yep, that's what I see from here.
Louis,
you don't have the sound on. Hit that button, please.
Including street maintenance, snow removal.
Okay, we'll try this again.
Hello, my name is Dale Wilson, Service Director for the City of Bellbrook. My department oversees many operations, including street maintenance, snow removal, stormwater sewers, traffic control devices, and our public water system. Today, we're going to share with you an overview of our water system.
Most people don't realize what it takes to provide water that's safe for drinking, cooking, and recreation. The water system must also provide ample water when our fire department rushes into action. Let's take a look at the many components it takes to provide water for all of our many needs. Some are apparent, such as water towers, fire hydrants, and personnel. Some components are underground or inside water system facilities and includes planning and water treatment. The water system is a groundwater system that pulls from the Little Miami Buried Aquifer. The city has a total of 9 production wells capable of producing up to 3,960,000 gallons of water per day. Once the water is pumped from the ground, it must travel to the water plant for treatment before it reaches the first customer. After the water reaches the water plant, the first treatment process is disinfection. The water then travels to the clear wells, which hold a total of 300,000 gallons of water and is part of the disinfection process by allowing contact time. The water is then pumped from the clear wells using 3 variable speed high service pumps that can pump up to 2,700 gallons of water per minute depending on demand. The final treatment process is the EPA required fluoridation, and at this point the water is considered to be finished water. Finished water is then tested in the lab for the correct levels of disinfection chemicals and fluoride to ensure we stay within the EPA guidelines. The service department is well qualified to operate the water system. We currently have 1 Class 2 operator, 3 Class 1 operators, and 1 employee with a distribution license, and 5 lab-certified employees. All water plant functions must be performed 7 days a week, 365 days per year. Once the water leaves the water plant, it uses more than 50 miles of water main to carry the water to over 9,000 customers. Included in the distribution system are the standpipes and water towers. The high service pumps must be strong enough to pump water against 330 feet of head to be able to fill the towers. This correlates to elevation measured in feet from water level to the top of the water towers. The water towers serve 2 functions. First, the height of the water in the towers is the control measure for maintaining water system pressure. And second, they provide 1,450,000 gallons of water storage. The service department also has the responsibility for maintaining the distribution system. This includes reading water meters, replacing water meters, repairing broken water main, and service line. Some water mains have been installed since 1948. We have up to 15 water main breaks per year, which unfortunately most happen during the winter season. We also flush, repair, and maintain more than 550 fire hydrants. Year to date, we have completed more than 3,340 customer-related work work. Do you find yourself asking what keeps your water safe? The service department adheres to strict EPA requirements for maintaining water quality. Our water sampling includes the following.
So again, that's just a brief overview of the water system, but I thought it did a good job.
My name is Dale Wilson, service director for the...
Some information about the water system, and Dale and Ryan Paisley are here. If you have any questions specifically about the water system, they'd be happy to answer those. They'd love to, actually.
No review
you might not
of our water system.
But they'd love to come up and you know, be put on the spot. So. But if there are any questions, I'll go through the rest of my presentation.
Nice video.
Yeah.
Well done.
It was informative.
I thought it was good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, like I said, we'll put that out in various areas. You know, just if anyone has questions, a lot of people don't have any idea where their water comes from. They just know they turn their tap on and there's water there, and there's a lot more that goes into it before it gets to that point. So a couple other charts that I've created here to give you some talk, and then we'll talk about the water rates. This is our water plant production. These are some statistics that Mr. Wilson prepares on an annual basis. But you can see that 2012 was our peak year. The water plant actually produced 325 million gallons of water that year. That has gone down by almost 50 million gallons over the last 2 years because 2012 was an extremely warm year that year. So you can see the variation that we have from year to year in the plant
which
production, but
a total
the
of 300,000 gallons
even
of water
in 2012
as part of the disinfection
program. Okay. Try this again. Even in 2012, when we had that peak amount of usage here, we still, the water tables weren't to the point that we were running low. The service department also tracks the water tables, and they know at what level those are. So we did not have any issues in that year. Another statistic that we started to track, this is the amount of water that we bill. We bill on a quarterly basis. And so there's three cycles. So every quarter there's three different cycles, and this tells you how much by quarter. So if you start out, this was the end of 2013, and then throughout 2014. And what you'll see is there's a spike always in the fourth quarter. What that is catching up on irrigation systems, because we bill in arrears. The majority of our irrigation systems are in one section. They get billed in November. That usage is really from July through October. So that's why you see it in the fourth quarter more than that. And I've got a couple other slides you'll see a little bit more. But this is what we bill. And if you look at these, and it doesn't match up exactly, but if you added up these four numbers, it's about 90% of the amount of water that is produced. So there's about a 10% loss, and that's because of if there's a fire, if we flush hydrants, if we're anything like that, that water, if there's a water main break, those are all things that water goes away. But that's about what that should be. If it was anything more than that, we would be more concerned, but about 10% is where that number should be.
Mark, overall though, that shows, I mean, you know, obviously have the spike in 12, but that shows an overall continuing decline of water usage. And I guess I find that counterintuitive.
But I think if you look back at these last two summers and you went to irrigation usage, I think you would probably find that that's where there's a significant drop. And I'll show you something here in a minute. I think you'd be surprised at how much we provide for irrigation.
Okay.
So just as the number of accounts has increased, not significantly, but since the fourth quarter of 2013 through the fourth quarter of last year, we've gone, this is the number of accounts that we actually bill, so just under 4,000 accounts. So we've gone up by 59 accounts in that time frame. Now, mind you, any new home that has an irrigation system right now, that comes in as two separate accounts. We bill them separately if you have an irrigation system. And the breakdown of those accounts are obviously primarily residential. That's where the majority of our, that's almost 82% are residential. We have another 440, about 11% are irrigation. But we really have a very small amount that are either commercial or apartments or other, which are city facilities, schools, things of that nature. So really where the bulk of our usage and meters are residential. This is the average residential usage, again, over those last four quarters. It doesn't, this is just residential. This does not include irrigation. Irrigation is separate from this. And it surprises me really how fairly consistent it is. It ranges between 4,200 and 4,700 gallons per month for a residential customer. You can see where it drops down. Again, some of that, if you don't have an irrigation system, you're gonna see a drop in the months where somebody's not watering their lawn. It's only if you have a separate irrigation meter that you're billed separately. But if you water your lawn using your regular water, that's where that'll be. Average irrigation usage, and I guess this is that number. So that's how much. That's 43,000 gallons is the average irrigation for that quarter, mm-hmm. as opposed to 13,000 for your wow. domestic. So if you're using that, if you're using an irrigation system, you're using a lot of water, particularly in that. So
yeah, usage-wise, that's four times.
Yes. Yep. So that's where I think some of those. That's why you see some of that dropping off, particularly in the last two years where we've not had much irrigation usage. And really, if you think about it, these numbers are probably low because of that same reason. These are only measuring periods that haven't had that usage. So looking now at our revenue, you can see again the $1.64 million was in that year where the drought was, and then that has dropped down significantly for those 2 years tying to that production. We budgeted again 1.53. That's a guess, because if you can predict the weather, you'd be better than most of our weathermen in the area. But what we have had is a positive increase in our water fund balance. As Ms. Middlesetter was saying earlier, whether that's tap-in fees or whether that's the surplus that we get from that water usage, that's what we're setting aside so that we have the ability to do capital improvements to the system over the years. So you can see in that year, particularly in 2012, when it was a drought, we had a surplus there. It sort of leveled out, and as we do capital projects, as we go and do the replacement of the water main on North Main Street, we have water towers that need to be repainted, we have water main to be replaced, that balance will steady out or even decrease in some years. So with that information, what we're looking at is a rate proposal is to not increase water rates again. The ordinance as it's written has the ability to increase it by the Consumer Price Index annually by motion of council, but my recommendation is to not increase that. Our water bill is for a typical water system customer is in two forms. There's $8.90 that's a base charge for the first 1,000 gallons. If you use 500, you get charged $8.90. And then it's $3.90 for every 1,000 gallons after that. So as an example of that, those two rates there, and then down here is what your quarterly bill. So you get billed $8.90 every month. You get billed, if you're a typical user, you get billed another $13.65. So you're paying $22.55 per month for your water. Quarterly, you see a bill of about $67. If your bill is higher than that, don't forget there's another $39 for trash that's on there. So the average bill that we send out is right around $100 is what we're mailing to people. Obviously, people that have bigger families may use more than that, but that's what we're doing. So based on that, we're recommending not to increase the water again. So what the average annual water bill, again, based on that 4,500 gallon average usage, For the fifth consecutive year, if we don't increase it, will be $271 will be what people typically play. If you compare that to Greene County, based on their proposed 2015 rates, that they're increasing them by 2%, they're paying $346, so they're paying $75 more per year than what our customers are for water. And we've been able to hold these rates steady for a number of years, and as I showed you before, our fund balance is still increasing, so we're not holding rates steady and not being able to provide for future capital improvements. We're able to do both of those things. Another aspect of this that we talked about earlier was tap-in fees. Tap-in fees, as you can tell, can be all over the place. These are annual numbers. You can tell where things were going great, and then you can tell where the economy sort of went south and there was no new housing development. You can see where they came back up. This year here, 2013, is where the Vineyard Section 1 really came online. But then there were some other developments there. So there were 44 tap-in permits that year. Last year we had 20. This year at 75,000, we're estimating about 25. If the Vineyard Section 2 goes in, if there's developments in the township that we provide, that number could be low, but that was the estimate that we used in the 2015 budget. So what I'm recommending is that we increase that tap-in fee at least slightly, and that we are currently at $2,800. And if you look back at that previous slide, every tap-in for the last 3 years has been 3/4 inch or less. So we don't get a lot of the larger tap-ins. So really, that's the number that matters the most, is this $2,800. An increase to 3,000, that would be about a 7% increase, but it hasn't been increased since 2010. And then correspondingly, you could increase all the other ones. Again, there's no real science or equation to this, but it's just trying to project what our costs are going to be in the future. The reality is over time, we're going to run out of tap-in fees. There's not going to be more tap-in fees coming as development in our service area
kind of reaches a saturation point,
right,
so to speak.
No pun intended there, but yeah. This is not something you're going to act on tonight, but I guess I'm looking for your feedback in terms of the tap-in fees, and then we can provide legislation at a future meeting. And just to give you some idea, Greene County, their tap-in fee is $3,500. A lot of communities do things differently. The only other easy one that I could find online was Springboro, and theirs is over $3,900 for a tap-in fee. So I don't think we're out of the norm by any stretch. We're probably on the low side, if anything, with those numbers. And then the last thing I want to talk about, irrigation accounts. I mentioned that the way we bill now is, if you have an irrigation system, it's a separate account, and it's a separate meter. We get probably more complaints on that than most things, because people get two bills. Sometimes they don't see the second one. They wonder why we're doing it. And the other thing is, the way it's set up, we bill people a monthly minimum for the irrigation system year round. So we sent out bills in February, and people got a bill for $27 for a monthly minimum for irrigation, when who uses irrigation system in February? So we get a lot of complaints about that also. So I've been working with Mr. Wilson. What we're trying to do is come up with two things. One, we'd like to make it to combine it so we can send out one invoice, so people can say one bill, and we can make it easier on them. And then I would propose that we eliminate the monthly minimum for irrigation. If probably 99% of them have a domestic account, they're paying a monthly minimum on those. There are a few irrigation-only accounts, but they're not very many. So if you're fine with that, again, I'll prepare legislation to make the amendments to all this and bring it to you, and we can do the public hearing. But I just wanted to go over some of those highlights here this evening with you and answer any questions you may have.
How many irrigation meters?
440-some, yes.
And you read them every 3 months, Dale?
And almost all of them are in one section.
Yeah.
Of the 440, I think 400 of them are in one section. You know, more obviously the newer developments, that they're the ones that have irrigation systems.
So how far along are we with the wireless meters that you can?
We are currently.
All right, Dale, we're going to make
now you got to come up here.
If you're going to talk, no one else in the TV world can hear you.
It was John's fault.
No, Dale Wilson. Bob made you come up.
Thank you, Bob.
I love that. What's your part?
Okay. We are currently 75% completed. Now, I have enough meters in stock right now to take that number up to 86%. So, and we have more than enough money budgeted for 2015 to complete the process.
Great.
Good.
So right now, I imagine the weather is what's holding you.
Well, the weather, plus we work around the billing cycle, so we're not out there changing meters as we're getting ready to read them for the billing clerk to be able to get the proper usage and things like that. So
gotcha.
We play that game quite a sure. bit too, but we sure. have quite a bit. We're going to get started again as soon as the weather allows.
Okay.
And
thank you.
How much revenue would that reduce?
You know, I tried to run some numbers. That's a pretty difficult one to sort of pin down. But the other thing that I had proposed, and this was, or I had thought about, but it's about the monthly minimum. I estimated about $25,000 a year is what we'd lose. Now, what I thought about was raising that the price for the water from the $3.90 to something to sort of offset that, but then you only get billed for what you're used. There's a conflict with that if we want to have them on one account, a software yep. issue with that. So I don't want to say, it would be nice if I could do that, but I'm not sure that I can. So I would say eliminate the monthly minimum, charge it the same rate potentially, and I'll have the answer for that before I introduce it. But that's yep. what my thought was.
Well, it's got to save some money and have one bill too.
Yes.
It seemed like from your charts though that the irrigation price or the bills for irrigation were low in the first three quarters and then really high in the fourth quarter. And I guess I would expect it to be more in the third quarter, right? Kind of after the summer is when the irrigation bills should be high.
But the biggest one is in November. That's when we bill it in November. That reading was actually taken in the beginning of October for the 3 months prior to that. So it's
okay.
August, September, well, it's actually July, September, October is mm-hmm. when that big section that has 400 of the meters, that's their reading, and that's when most of the irrigation. So they don't get billed to November for usage in July, September, October.
I just was thinking that just because I'm in the rates department at DP&L,
right.
is that usually you try to price it so that customers have an idea about what they're using at the time that they're using it. Because if they don't know, you know, that they're sitting, that their irrigation system is sitting there just spitting out the water and then they don't get a bill until November, it might be a shock to them.
And we have that. We have that mm-hmm. issue. And that's actually one of the things that I've talked with Dale about with the radio reads. Although we're going to continue to read on a quarterly basis, we can go out and read the meters on a monthly basis and check. There's reports that we can run for high-low so we can catch things sooner than we're catching them now. Because what happens now is on that one, we read in October and there's a report that runs, and if it's an extremely high, and Mr. Schweller can attest to this, if it's an extremely high, then we contact the person and say, okay, you might have a leak. We're going to come out and do a test or whatever needs to happen. So with the radio reads, we'll be able to do that on a more real-time basis. We're not going to bill on a monthly basis, but we'll at least be able to run those reports and put some threshold that says if it's above this, we need to contact that person sooner rather than later.
Okay.
Because we do bill really in arrears for what we're doing. It's already gone by the time we...
Right.
Yeah. Especially on a quarterly basis.
Everything's brown and good by the time you get the bill.
Yeah.
They forgot they watered it.
Mark, the increases on the meter sizes in excess of an inch, were those basically just the same percentages? You just took the same percentage?
Yeah, what this
went across.
The table, it's a 5%, but it rounds up to the nearest $100, yeah. so is what okay. it is. So that's why it's a little bit more on the lower end. But as you get down, it's probably pretty close to a 5%.
And realistically?
I asked Dale, I don't know that we've ever had anything anywhere down at the bottom of this table. I mean, we might have an inch and a half one.
Schools or something.
But yeah, for a new commercial structure.
A school. Yeah.
Right.
But we don't have.
But again, just to keep it
yeah.
consistent.
Yes. Yeah, it is a 5%, and it's just a rounding thing as to gotcha. What it actually ends up being.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions on council?
Sounds like the way to go.
Yeah, I mean, I like the idea. I mean, I don't have one, but as a consumer, I know I would certainly appreciate saying the months I'm not using it to pay a minimum fee seems kind of crazy. So I'm sure there'd be plenty of people that would appreciate that.
Yeah, I think so too. In the utility world, you think a meter charges
right.
by month, but I think it's a good idea.
Well, and we're getting that for their domestic one already.
Exactly.
And we are still going to charge that.
Meter.
We're getting
yeah.
one,
yeah.
and it's just that second
yep.
meter we're not going to charge
yep.
that for.
Not to get too rates geeky on you, but
yeah.
is there any time when we don't want people to run their irrigation system, and so we should try to give them a signal or tell them, can you stop, or give them a price spike or something when there's a problem on the system?
I suppose there could be a time if there was ever a serious drought where, you know, our ability to produce the water was there, but we've not had that since I've been here, where we've had to restrict. I know some places will go, I mean, you could do it on the rate side, or you could do it on the, you know, alternate day thing, or turn it off, or only do it on certain days, or things like that, but.
You have watering odd and even days and those things, addresses, but I think the idea is, we also like to sell water. So the more you use, the better, up until the point that the wells are some. Yeah, now, Greene County has had it, and Cables Mill, so you know which side you lived on. If you're in the Bellbrook side, you never had any issues. You lived in Greene County, you had watering bans. So, and typically that's where it start, watering bans.
Yeah, they just advertise it.
But we've never had any problems.
Not recently, I mean, it's not, it's been.
Well, we have new wells, whatever, new anymore, but.
Yeah.
I mean, our laws are like 30 to 40 feet deep, and the lowest the table ever been, probably 16 feet from ground up.
I want my driveway cleaned. Early street.
Yeah.
So.
We're, you know, I think it's a good proposal to not pay that during the, I mean, that makes sense. Now, Greene County sewer charges you whether you got water turned on or not.
Not on the, not, at least that's the whole idea of having two meters.
Well, they have a monthly minimum also, even if they don't have the water on. So they're going to do that regardless.
And that, on the sprinkler systems, they don't have to pay sewer, so.
Right.
Right. I'm just saying.
And that's the reason to have the separate meter.
Yep.
Right.
All right.
Okay, well then I'll prepare legislation and we can introduce it the next time and go from there.
Any other new business to come before council? Moving on then, open discussion.
I have nothing tonight, Mayor.
Mr. Greenwood?
I have nothing.
Nothing tonight, Mayor.
Nothing.
Donna?
Just want to say thank you to Scott Carlson for volunteering for the Village Green Board.
Yep, thank you very much, Scott.
Nothing for tonight, Mayor.
And I don't believe I have anything, but this is the time I will open it up to the audience to see if anyone would like to come up. You would just need to come up and say your name and address, and you can have up to 5 minutes. I don't see anyone jumping up. I do see two young gentlemen sitting up here in the front. Would you guys like to come up and tell what troop you're with and what you're here for?
Sure.
Come on up to the speaker.
And still awake.
Citizenship. Well, I'm trying to get these badges right. Citizenship or
in community? The community.
Community. There's a city pin. Just go ahead and tell your name and tell them what you're doing here.
My name's Brody Vaughn, and I'm here for Troop 375, and I'm here trying to get my community merit badge today. And I thought it was really interesting to hear about the water tower and the leaves on it and stuff. And some of the stuff kind of confused me because I don't like know what most of it meant. But I hope like understand it more in the future. And I'm gonna like look it up and stuff and research it.
Very good.
Very nice job.
We were confused.
My name is John Alex. I'm from Troop 375. I'm trying to get my community merit badge. And I thought this was all interesting. I liked pretty much all of it. A little bit was confusing too. There's a few Googles, and thank you for having us.
You're very welcome. Thank you very much for coming. Does any other member on council have any other business this evening to come before us this evening? If not, seeing no other.
Mayor. None.
Seeing none, this meeting is adjourned.